Hello, friends. Welcome back to another weekly devotional. I am so glad you are joining us. I am glad we're back. It's been a little bit of a break because we did so much during Advent and Christmas that I needed a time off to kind of just, you know, recharge my batteries. And I'm sure you got tired of seeing my face every single day. I know I got tired of seeing my face when we were doing the editing process. So we're back. We're going to be doing devotionals twice a week for a little while. That may change coming up. Who knows? But right now we are going to do twice a week, and we're going to have a little bit of a different structure. So in the old devotions, I would always do the announcements first. Well, like we're doing with the worship services, we're doing announcements last. And I won't be like telling you what the announcements are. I'm just going to have slides up on the screen for you to see that will be your way of seeing the announcements on this devotion. Now, the thing is, if you have any other questions, you can feel free to reach out to me or anybody else that you think is going to know information about it, like Soup Kitchen, things like that. And we'll all be glad to kind of help you out through that. But the fact of the matter is, we're just trying to change the structure a little bit, so that way we just go ahead and get to the devotion first, so that way if you know what the announcements are for that day, you don't have to fast forward. Instead, you can just cut it off after you're done. But I do highly encourage you to watch the announcements after the fact, because it's not super long, just to make sure that you are in the know of what all is going on in our church right now. Because, you know, times are strange. We're not actually in church yet, and so hopefully that'll change sometime in the near future, but as of right now we're not. So to keep up with things, you have to know what is going on through our announcements. That is kind of why they're important. So I've said all that, I've said enough of it. I'm not going to go on the big spiel about that anymore today or otherwise, and so just watch the announcements after the devotion itself, and I hope that you enjoyed today's devotion. So now let's turn to our scripture today, which comes from the Old Testament. Our scripture today comes from 2 Kings chapter 8, verses 1 through 6, and this is from the Common English Bible. Elisha spoke to the woman whose son he had brought back to life. "You and your household must go away and live wherever you can, because the Lord has called for a famine. It is coming to the land, and it will last 7 years." So the woman went and did what the man of God asked. She and her household moved away, living in Philistia 7 years. When 7 years had passed, the woman returned from Philistia. She went to appeal to the king for her house and her farmland. The king was speaking to Gehazi, the man of God's servant, asking him, "Tell me about all the great things Elisha has done." So Gehazi was telling the king how Elijah had brought the dead to life. At that very moment, the woman whose son he had brought back to life began to appeal to the king for her house and her farmland. Gehazi said, "Your majesty, this is the woman herself, and this is her son, the one Elijah brought to life." The king questioned the woman, and she told him her story. Then the king appointed an official to help her, saying, "Return everything that belongs to her, as well as everything that the farmland has produced, starting from the day she left the country until right now." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Today's scripture is one of many examples of where God is showing God's faithfulness to those who are faithful to God, where God is present with God's people in the midst of troubling times or difficult times in their lives. As we see many times in Scripture, there are miracles left and right of healing, resurrection, and things like that. And that's kind of like what's going on here. We also have this idea of God telling a woman, this woman in 2 Kings 8, who I'll tell you more about in a second, where she is told through the prophet Elisha, E-L-I-S-H-A, to leave the land for 7 years because there's about to be a famine in this land. And we don't want you to, you know, deal with that because you have been faithful. And then so she leaves. And then she comes back in 7 years and she goes to the king and appeals to the king and says, King, please let me have my land back. I want my home back. Where me and my child here, we're trying to come back home. And what's so interesting about that is that right beside the king is Gehazi. Gehazi was the servant to Elisha, and there he was able to tell that this is the woman whose son was revived or resurrected, brought back to life by Elijah. So it's really, the king was asking, tell me about this Elisha. And so Gehazi was like, you're looking at evidence of where God had worked through this prophet. And so what's really cool about this is that this is connecting to two other stories. So this woman was a rich woman who was a Shunammite. And the Shunammite woman was very generous or hospitable to Elisha when he would come into town. She gave him a place to stay, gave him food to eat, things like that. Very hospitable. And she even made a room for him in her home, up in the attic, if you will. And so he could have a place to stay every time he came through. And out of that generosity, Elisha said, let me repay you. And so what he did is he gave her the gift of having a child, her own flesh and blood, which she was not able to have but prior. And so that was a blessing, right? Well, later on in life, as the child grew up, he developed some sort of illness or had some sort of injury or accident or something, and he came complaining to his father, my head hurts, and he dies. The mother's so upset and everything, but what she does is she says, I got to talk to this man of God. I've got to find Elisha. And so she sets off on a donkey to find Elisha. And when she finds him, she pleads with him, why did you give me this child only to take him away? And Elisha did not know that this had happened. God had not given this information to Elisha. As you would think, a prophet should know these things. But instead, Elijah said, you have been faithful. I'm going to go with you and let's see your son. And so what he did is he went and he actually revived her son, brought him back to life. Now, the way he does it is really strange. It's very strange. And if you want to read more about it, it happens in 2 Kings chapter 4, verses 8 through 37. And so go ahead and take a look at it if you want, but the way he does it is just weird. But it still happens, right? He still is revived. He's still brought back to life. And this is an example of what happens when you are faithful with God. God is with you during these difficult times, and God will guide you through them, and God will deliver you through them. And now, the reason why this story was so important in a way is because it also paralleled something that happened from the prophet before him, Elijah, E-L-I-J-A-H. Now, you've heard of the prophet Elijah, but the prophet Elijah in 1 Kings chapter 17 verses 8 through 24 did something similar where he went to Zarephath and he went up to this widow, and the widow was collecting sticks to help prepare her meal for her and her son. And he asked her of water. So she gets him water. And then he asks her for some bread. And she's like, sir, as sure as I am standing before you, as sure as I am telling this to you, swearing to God, I don't have hardly anything to give. I barely have this little bit of flour, and I'm collecting sticks for me and my son to eat. And so he blessed her with the ability to never run out of food. So it was like this idea of giving her all this food, right? To make sure she would not go hungry in her struggles. She would not be forgotten about by God. God gave her a gift, a blessing, if you will, for being faithful. But that's not where it stops. It doesn't stop there. Just like with in the Shunammite woman, you also have this instance where her son becomes ill and dies. And Elijah brings him back to life, just very similarly to the way Elisha does it. still disturbing in a way of how it works, like how it happens. And I would encourage you to read it to kind of see what I'm talking about in the way it's described. But it's still important because he was revived. So we see here two instances, three instances if you count the actual story that we read today, but two instances of miracles of reviving or resurrection, like we see oftentimes in the New Testament with Jesus resurrecting Lazarus and things like that. But you see these instances in the Old Testament, and we think about New Testament, where God is present in our lives and God is there with us, helping get us through these difficult situations. Now, unlike back then, we don't see miracles of people being brought back from the dead, really. We just don't see that. We don't see prophets coming and actually laying hands on someone or doing something like that and someone just come back to life. It just doesn't happen. But what does happen is that God is with us each and every day. And as we are faithful to God and faithful to God's work and being a part of God's mission and God's will, we are guided with God. We have God's presence with us. God is there to help us through. It's not that we're not going to suffer, because these people suffered. They had hard times. It doesn't say that their difficult times ended all of a sudden. No, it says that God was there with them. It says God was there to give them blessings amidst the difficult times, to give them hope amidst the difficult times. This is what we need to take from this. Even though we don't see these kinds of miracles today, we do see miracles of people going into remission. We do see miracles of people living in these very tragic, like, accidents and illnesses. And that's great. These are great things to see. And it is an opportunity for us to see God at work in the world. But most of the time, God is at work through us and with us. And what I mean by through us is that we can be blessings to other people's lives. God calls us to serve others through our love and our service. Jesus said it over and over, love your neighbor as yourself. And that's a big way that we are showing God's blessing on the world. If you think about it, think about the impact that the church has on people who are suffering through food scarcity or homelessness. Things like that. About racial justice, the church has been very influential about that. And we have to remember that this is critical for us to show love toward our neighbor, because we are inherently being the body of Christ. We are the hands and feet. We are going out and doing God's work on God's behalf today. We are like the prophets in the way, because we are going out and doing work on God's behalf. And so we think about it that way. So through us, we are doing that. But with us, God is with us and God works with us. And what I mean by that is that when we are sitting in difficult times and times that we struggle with, God is not leaving us. God does not go somewhere else because it's too hard to sit there with us. God has felt the pain that we feel through Jesus Christ. God knows what it's like to suffer. God knows that we feel very painful feelings and emotions, physical, etc. God sits with us in those times. God holds our hand and guides us. God wraps his embrace around us and gives us comfort and peace and hope. God does not forsake us because we have bad times. Just because something bad happens to us does not mean that we deserved it. It does not mean that God has brought it upon us. It does mean that the world is full of sinfulness and problems, and that God needs to be there with us to help us get through it. The reality is, friends, is that we're going through a pandemic. We're going through a terrible time politically where we're so divided. We're going through a terrible time in our nation where we're all divided in that way too. It's not just about politics anymore. It's not just about ideologies. We're divided in our own families. We're divided in our own churches. We're divided in society. We're divided over everything. And not to mention all the other illnesses other than the pandemic that's going on. Think about all of the violence that's taking place. Everything is harmful, and we need God to help guide us through it. And as we are faithful to God, as we show our faithfulness to God, whether it's through our service, through our worship, through our praise, our prayer, etc., we are trying to be faithful servants. And we are hoping and praying that God is going to be with us and guide us and comfort us through the difficult times. This is a beautiful, beautiful notion. And we see this in Scripture. We see this in what the Scripture said today, as well as we see it all over Scripture. So it is important that we remember this and take it with us and never forget. Will you pray with me? Gracious and loving God, we thank you for this message today. We thank you for your faithfulness to us as we try to serve you. We thank you for being with us through the difficult times. We thank you for helping guide us through those times. We thank you for all of the blessings that you have given us in our lives, and we are thankful and absolutely just filled with gratitude for your Son, Jesus. The one who came down here to save us, the one who came to show us the way, to show us what life looks like, as well as to bring us life. Just like your prophets Elijah and Elisha did, give us life, bring us up to what you would have us to be, bring us to your standards, bring us to your way, and help us to see that and always follow it. Lord, we ask all these things through your Son, Jesus. Amen. Friends, as you go this day, be faithful, be loving, and be in God's will. And remember that God does not leave you or forsake you, that God is always wanting to be on your side and to guide you and comfort you during the most difficult of times. I hope you go in peace, and I hope you have a great day. And I'll see you next time. Don't forget, announcements next.